Hier achter mij ligt Silicon Valley, midden in de staat Californië in de Verenigde Staten. En als autoliefhebber ben ik hier een beetje met dubbele gevoelens. Want als er één plek is in de wereld waar je nog ongegeneerd kunt genieten van auto's met 6-cilinder en 8-cilinder verbrandingsmotoren, dan is het wel hier. Behalve als het aan de bedrijven hier in deze vallei ligt, want die zijn hard bezig om de toekomst van deze auto's drastisch te veranderen. En dat maakt mij als journalist juist weer extra geïnteresseerd, want er vallen heel veel verhalen te halen. En daarom duiken we de komende tijd in Silicon Valley. Waar ligt de toekomst van de auto? In deze aflevering bezoeken we de beroemde Stanford University in Palo Alto. Hier werken studenten namelijk niet alleen aan de computers en smartphones van de toekomst. Er wordt ook grondig onderzoek gedaan naar de gevolgen en kansen van autonome auto's. Daarvoor richtte de universiteit het Center for Automotive Research at Stanford op, kortweg CARS. We spreken er met professor Wendy Yu. Waar houden zij en haar studenten zich nu precies mee bezig?
We're doing a lot of different kinds of experiments to understand how people interact and behave in the car. How they'll behave when the car is increasingly automated, what they might do with different kinds of interfaces or interactions. So we're just trying to understand how people are going to respond to all these different changes that are afoot. A lot of what we do in my research is simulate various different possible futures. So we have a driving simulator that lets us set up different kinds of scenarios that might happen and see how people will behave. We also have a few on the road driving simulators, which are actually actual cars, but that we set up to feel like autonomous cars or cars that can talk to you or cars which have different services. And we basically try to understand how people would respond naturally in those environments and use that to as material design the future. One of the things that we want to emphasize is that the future isn't this one secret path that we have to uncover, but rather a set of possibilities, you know, that what we get to pick. And one of the things that we think is important is that we need to understand exactly what we're picking between. So we're doing experiments where we simulate different possible futures and understand how people behave, and that helps us understand the larger implications of different design decisions. I think there are a lot of different opinions about how people factor in to the automotive future. I mean, I think I've heard a lot of people say that people are unpredictable, and so you have to figure out how to drive cars without them at all. Mm-hmm. But I think we're also losing sight of the fact that people are also really, really capable and really, really intelligent. And it's going to be a long time before we see machines that can compete with people. So if you want some of the benefits that you can offer through automated technology, you need to figure out how to work with people to make those things possible if you want them to happen in the near term.
Om die toekomst beter te kunnen begrijpen, heeft Stanford de beschikking over diverse auto's die in verschillende maten zelfstandig kunnen rijden. Daarmee voeren de studenten al jarenlang diverse onderzoeken uit, vaak samen met of in opdracht van de auto-industrie. In samenwerking met Ford proberen ze bijvoorbeeld te bepalen hoe een zelfrijdende auto zich ethisch gezien zou moeten gedragen in het verkeer.
One of the things that they want to do is to think about how to make people who are programming cars aware of the things that people care about, like it's possible to make cars that only follow rules very strictly, but that means that if you come upon a car which is stopped in the road and you can never go around that car because that's not legal. When we actually drive, we are actually negotiating all the time between what's legal and what, you know, actually makes sense in the moment.
Yeah.
And it's really hard for people who are programming the car to think about all those situations. So I think that's without knowing all the details of what's going on, that's what that research project is looking at.
Yeah.
So that is an actual car that can perform autonomous driving that was supplied by Ford, but then Professor Gerges' team is actually working on how to program that. The car next to it is just a stock Prius V. It's just a conventional car, but we can use it to do experiments to instrument how people drive the car, how they might drive the car if the car had the capability to talk to them, for example, and figure out if we can learn when are good times, for example, to start conversations, or if there are ways that talking to people can confuse them or disrupt their driving. We can also do things like think about the car not just as a thing that you drive, but also like an environment. Like we can actually use, we can prototype things like in-car services where the car works with you to think about how much you're sleeping, you know.
Oh, really?
And yeah, and like basically give some sleep counseling and address sleep fatigue, which is a big problem for drivers. One thing that happens is that people like already right now use the car as a good place to learn new things. Like you hear about people practicing language learning online.
Right.
If the car is driving by itself, you know, or doing a lot more automation, you might actually kind of take advantage of that time to do a lot more different kinds of learning. For example, it might be possible to use a heads-up display or immersive ambient display environments to teach people things and then keep them alert and awake for when they might have to take over the car.
Het onderzoek van professor Yu en haar studenten bracht tot nu toe al verschillende interessante inzichten aan het licht, vooral aan de hand van diverse reissimulators. Kennis die Stanford vervolgens deelt met autofabrikanten, zodat zij de auto's van de toekomst beter geschikt kunnen maken.
I do really take issue with OEMs and technology companies who say like, oh look, here's a phenomenon. For example, drivers get sleepy in autonomous cars and therefore this is a sign that we can't have partial automation. And I think, well, drivers get sleepy, but in some of our research, you can actually keep them awake if you can keep them entertained. We set up three conditions where people were either reading on an iPad, watching a movie on an iPad, or supervising the vehicle. And we were looking to understand whether the thing that you're doing before that switch from automated driving to manual driving affects your driving ability, your ability to handle routine events like car cutoffs. Mm-hmm. And what we found was that people who were told to supervise the car would fall asleep.
Okay.
Inside of 8 minutes.
Within 8 minutes?
Within
people
eight
fall
is
asleep?
Crazy. It's crazy.
Really?
But what we also found is that people who were in the other conditions where they're watching a movie or reading didn't have any problems staying awake. So that tells us not only that there's a problem, but there are also possible solutions. So now, I don't actually think that what we should be doing is giving people iPads, but it means that if you actually keep people mentally engaged and alert, even if it's not on the driving task, that they're going to be far more available if you actually need them to do something in the future.
Bestuurders vallen dus gemiddeld al na 8 minuten in slaap in een autonome auto. Dat klinkt schokkend, maar volgens professor Yu tonen de experimenten op Stanford over het algemeen toch aan dat mensen hun auto erg goed onder controle hebben.
What you're actually saying is that the humans driving nowadays are very skilled.
Yes,
so
I think
is there driving, a need for autonomous driving then?
I think on the whole, people are very, very skilled drivers, and
okay.
It's going to be really hard to replicate people's driving in general. On the other hand, it's really hard for people to maintain vigilance over long periods of time. So for example, people who are doing like trucking
yeah.
have a hard time kind of staying alert for hours on end, and that's something that a machine can do really well. You know, especially if the drive is boring.
Yeah.
A drive that's boring is really easy for a machine and hard for a person.
Right.
So it's interesting. So in some ways that suggests that if you can combine the best features of a person and a machine, you could actually get much better driving overall.
Yeah.
And then, you know, I think a lot of the things that are the most exciting for us are slightly less controlled, but some experiments that we're doing to understand like what people enjoy doing in the car. So one thing, for example, is when people are interacting with the car and talking to the car about driving, that helps them stay alert, and they like to have input on what's going on, and they're not correcting the car because the car is doing a bad job.
Yeah.
They're correcting the car because they expect to have input because they're in the car. I often joke about this as sort of like how I interact with my husband.
Right.
My husband is not a bad driver. My husband's a wonderful driver. But when I'm in the car, I point out, you know, things that I see, and
right.
I ask him to speed up and slow down. And that's not any lack of confidence on my part. You know, but it's because I expect to be accommodated because I'm also a participant in the driving.
Sure.
So I think that when people are in an autonomous car, that they will expect that same level of input and control.
And what do you do with that information?
I mean, we publish this information, you know, in the academic sector, and then we actually also work with people in the automotive industry to understand what that means about how they might design cars. And we don't always get to have a decision-making,
mm-hmm.
you know, capability, but we have influence on the decisions that they make.
Zelfrijdende auto's zijn volgens Stanford University een onvermijdelijk onderdeel van de toekomst. Maar dat betekent volgens professor Wendy Yu niet dat we over 10 jaar allemaal in rijdende bioscoopjes over snelwegen zullen suizen.
I don't know what a car will look like in 10 years. I've seen a lot of visions of the future where they have people sit in different configurations away from facing forward. What we have found is those configurations make people incredibly motion sick.
Yeah.
So the cars could move slower and more gradually, and then you can move the chair around. But I think what's more likely is that the cars will face forward.
Yeah.
And then we'll try to think of other ways to make that, you know, the fact that you're sitting face forward.
So we shouldn't expect a very big revolution inside of the cabin.
I mean, one of the things in California, because the weather is nice for older cars, is that we have cars, like many cars, which are like 20, 30, 40, 50 years old on the road right now. And that's going to continue to be the case that far into the future. And so anything that we have going on now needs to be compatible with the old cars. So I think it's going to be a long time before we have cars that can't drive on the roadways that we have now. And so because of that, we're going to have, it's going to be a long time before the cars really change their form factor.
Because of the old cars, the new cars will have a very gradual way of adapting.
Yeah, I mean, in this way, form follows function. And so the way that the cars look has to do with the way that we drive the cars. And I don't think the way that we're going to drive the cars is going to change that much, even if it's the car that's driving.